Hey, brothers and sisters, this is Brother Patrick. Yeah, I just wanted to give a word to the Lord. It's put a lot into my spirit, and I'm trying to put it all together and say exactly what He wants me to say. But the Lord has given me, you know, the name Beulah Land, Hephzibah and Beulah Land. And in the text from Isaiah 62, it's talking about the land of Israel be not longer forsaken, but to become my delight. Hephzibah is the word for delighting. Beulah Land is married. And the Lord was giving me that text, but in this reference is for the church to be our name to be changed, you know, from the bride to married already. Bride meaning getting married to Beulah. Beulah Land, you know, just like there's a song, you know, about Beulah Land. Not just the earthly land of Israel, God's physical manifestation on earth, but His heavenly manifestation. You know, the New Jerusalem and His bride, the bride of Christ, the land of Israel. Israel, the nation, being the bride of the Father, as Romans chapter 9, 10, and 11 tells us, that for the sake of the Father, you know, Israel is the apple of the Father's eye, and then we, the church, made up of all the nations of the world, we are the bride of Christ, and we're about to become Beulah, to become married, not going to be married, or betrothed. Now we've been betrothed. When you get saved, you become part of the bride that is betrothed. Now we're about to become Beulah, which is married to the Lord. The Lord is just pressing me to match that text with the Damascus Road experience of the Apostle Paul, Acts chapter 9, and the Lord is just wanting me to say, you know, because I keep trying to teach about the end times, but the Lord keeps giving me that message, you know, about those, you know, this is a year of Jubilee, brothers and sisters. As Jesus quoted from that, Isaiah 61, the Spirit of the Lord is upon me. And He quoted from there, and He stopped in the middle of Isaiah 61, verse 1 and 2. But in the New Testament, Luke chapter 4, verse 16 and 17, the Lord just stopped in the middle of that text and said, the acceptable year of the Lord. He didn't say the next verse, which is the year of the vengeance of our Lord, the vengeance of our God. That's the tribulation period. So the year of Jubilee is one way of describing the age of grace, the church age. And so that's what the Lord wants me to tell you. That's the whole stumbling block with people. You know, and so I'm going to title this video, you know, Word from the Lord. Don't miss the narrow gate. And so the Lord gave me that title because He wants religious people to watch this video. So when I say that, religious people is going to say, oh yeah, He's going to tell them they need to follow the law. Or as a self-righteous person would say, the Torah. You know, even though they're not from Israel, they don't speak native Hebrew as their mother tongue, but they want to use and throw around these big words in Hebrew. And there's nothing wrong with that, calling it the Torah, but using the Hebrew word. But what the Lord wants you to know, it's just like Saul of Tarsus on the road to Damascus, as Saul told us later on in his writings. You know, he said he was zealous for the law, you know, and he was ahead of his peers, you know, and he was on his way to being, you know, somebody like his teacher Gamaliel. He was on his way to becoming a famous rabbi, a famous member of the Sanhedrin. But he had what we call the Damascus Road experience. The Lord appeared unto him and said, Saul, Saul, why are you persecuting me? And Saul said, who are you? And he said, who are you, Lord? And he said, I am Jesus who you're persecuting. But the Lord wants me to say to you, like it says in the King James, He told Paul, it's hard for you to kick against the pricks. Or, you know, the word is in the NIV is goad, which is a big stick they would use to poke the oxen in the behind to get them to go, you know, to goad someone. You know, or in the King James word, they use a prick, but it's a stick that you would use to poke them in their hindquarters to make the oxen keep moving. And that's what the Lord was saying. He had already goaded Paul, or Saul of Tarsus, the same guy, had goaded him many times toward the gospel, but Saul had resisted. Even when he watched Stephen being stoned, he resisted. And so lots of people will read that and then think bad about Saul. Look, Saul is a perfect example of grace. You know, he was an evil guy. He was killing the Christians. And then he's also a perfect example of all the Judaizers that's on YouTube. And that's the message that the Lord gave me. He was zealous for the law, persecuting Christians, people who were into grace. And guess what? Jesus said, why do you persecute me? He didn't say, why are you persecuting my people? Jesus said, what you've done to the least of these, my brethren, you've done unto me. So Jesus said to him, why are you persecuting me? And Saul, of course, not being stupid, said, who are you, Lord? He didn't know who it was, but he knew it was the Lord because he appeared to him in a vision and a bright light and all that. Hey, he knew it was God. You know, and then he said, I am Jesus whom you are persecuting. And so it's hard for you to kick against the goads. And that's what's happening and with religious people. And that's what the Lord is said in his word in Matthew chapter 11. Come unto me, all you who are burdened and heavy laden, and I will give you rest. For my burden is easy and my yoke is light. And that's what the Beulah land is. That's what the second half of Hebrews chapter 3 and Hebrews chapter 4, it says that we have another rest to enter into. In the Old Testament, they had that, you know, God rested in Genesis on the seventh day. And then he told the children of Israel and commanded them to rest on the seventh day. And then when they were going to the promised land, they were supposed to enter into that rest. But because their message from God to enter into the promised land, to enter into rest in the land of Canaan and become the land of Israel, it says it was not mingled with faith. And they rejected it. So God left them in the wilderness for 40 years. And listen to me, brothers and sisters. There is a day coming imminently at hand that the Lord himself, and the Lord told me this too, the Lord is about. He said the verse from 1 Thessalonians chapter 4, verse 16 and 17, for the Lord is about to descend from heaven with a shout, with the voice of the archangel and the trumpet of God, and the dead in Christ shall rise first, and those of us who are alive and remain shall be caught up together with them to meet the Lord in the air. So we shall forever be with the Lord. Therefore, wherefore, comfort one another with these words. The rapture of the church is imminent. It's about to happen. We, all of us who are Christians who are following these things, we know that it's an imminent beginning of the tribulation. Before the tribulation will begin, the rapture is going to be happening. The Lord has not appointed us under wrath. Listen to me, brothers and sisters. Those of you who are striving, kicking against the goads of the Lord to surrender your life, the Lord has another rest for you to enter. It's not from the works you did. So that narrow way that Jesus said, narrow is the way. The narrow way is not following the law. The narrow way is not in your own righteousness. The narrow way is Jesus said, I am the way, the truth, and the life. He also said in John chapter 10, I am the gate. People want to be technical. He said, straight is the gate. Okay? In the King James, not straight is the way, straight is the gate. Jesus also said, I am the gate. I am the gate. John chapter 10. Jesus is the gate. He said that I am the bread of life. I am the gate. I am the good shepherd. I am the resurrection and the life. I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father except by me. So the way you're missing it, in all religions in the world, any religion you want to look at, they all teach that you can become a better person through your exercise of your morality and self-control and self-discipline and all that. And the Lord is calling you to himself. The Lord is standing on the other side of the river Jordan. And he's saying, hey, come on over. I'll even part the water for you. Like when Joshua and the children of Israel, and maybe it's in Joshua chapter 3 or 4, whatever, when they crossed the Jordan River, as soon as they stepped into the water with the ark, the Levites, actually the Kohens, the ones who were carrying the ark, that's the descendants of the children of Aaron, they stepped in up there in the Jordan River, and then the water parted. And they crossed over on dry land. That's what's happening for us in the church when we go in the rapture. And then when you get saved, the Lord is standing on the other side of Jordan. He's calling to you. He's calling you by name. And I know and I believe and I declare right now that the Lord will appear to you, that he'll speak to you, just like he did to the apostle who became the apostle Paul, Saul of Tarsus, when he was a religious zealot. And the Lord appeared to him and blinded him for 3 days, that by his blindness he might see the grace of God. And I already prayed yesterday for the lost, you know, the people who are living in sin. And now the Lord has led me today to take a message and pray for those religious people who are trying to earn the love of God and earn the grace of God and earn God's forgiveness, and have been taught that you can have your own righteousness to enter into the kingdom of heaven. I pray right now that you will know what the reformers said when they came out of the Dark Ages. You know, their cry was, in the Scripture alone, the Bible alone, in Christ alone, you know, by faith alone, in Him alone, by grace alone. That is the cry of the true gospel, the word that the Lord gave Martin Luther, that he built his, at that time, the move of God was going on. Now, of course, it's a dead religion, but at the time, the Bible verse that the Lord quickened Martin Luther with was, "The just shall live by faith." So if you're going to be justified, you have to live by faith. But faith in what? What you've done? No, if you could do it yourself, well, then you wouldn't need Christ, now would we? We wouldn't need Jesus to die on the cross for us, if the law was sufficient for us. If our good deeds, even apart from the law, our good deeds was good enough for us. The Bible says our deeds are like a filthy rag in the eyes of the Lord. I pray that you will receive, and the Lord will appear to you, the Lord will speak to you, the Lord will lead you to become blind to your own self-righteousness, that you might see the grace of God.